Well, we want to start our Bring It On session today by answering the question we discussed from Mildred. Pat, she says, 1 Corinthians 11:27 says, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. And verse 28 says, for he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself. I was living with a married man, went to church with his family, and took part in communion. I have since repented and am no longer living with this person. According to Scripture, have I damned my soul or have I been forgiven?
Wow. Terrible, Mildred, to have to carry that guilt with you. You know, you ask yourself, you're going to church with his family? I mean, does that mean wife? Does that mean children?
I don't know.
Weird. Anyhow, okay. The Bible says, those who do this, some of you are sick and some die. So this is a pretty serious matter. But there's nobody in a thing like this that's, quote, damned your soul for all eternity. The Lord is forgiving, and the Bible says he'll forgive all manner of sin and blasphemy. And Jesus died to forgive us, not to condemn us. He didn't come to condemn, but to save. So if you come to the Lord, ask his forgiveness, he will forgive, cleanse you, and you're free of that relationship, and you know, get on with life.
Okay, this is Kimberly, who says, I've recently given my life over to Christ, and I've already felt the grace of God and his Spirit within me. I'm now in love with Jesus and believe in him wholeheartedly. I'm wondering what I can do to spread the love of Jesus Christ, and what happens to those who don't accept him as their Lord and Savior?
Well, I'll answer the second part first. The Bible indicates very clearly that our own consciences will condemn us on the day of judgment. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it will excuse us or accuse us when the day of judgment. And when that happens, there's no hope. But you want to spread the love of the Lord, I think you do it where you live. Just let everybody know that the happiness, the joy you have, and they'll say, what's happened to you? Well, give a reason for the hope that's within you. And if the Lord has something more, it'll expand gradually from where you are. All right.
Okay, this is Lois, who says, everyone says the price of gold is so high now. There must be a reason people are buying gold. Should we hold on to our gold jewelry because we might need to use it for food? Will the American dollar really be worth nothing in the near future?
I don't subscribe to some of those doomsday scenarios, and I think gold is a commodity. It fluctuates. It has been very good. But remember, it went from, like, $260 an ounce or so up to $1,800. So it's come off now because it doesn't pay dividends, and some of the big boys haven't been playing quite as avidly as they had in the past. But yes, I'd hold on to your gold jewelry. I think it's had for a slump, but I wouldn't be so concerned about the dollar completely losing its value and so forth. But right now, the dollar has been remarkably strong. It's had a sell-off the last couple of days, but I think I'm amazed, frankly, because we're in trouble. We've done some bad things, but the other guys have done worse things. So, I mean, relatively speaking, the dollar's come out pretty well.
Okay, this is Jean Pat, who says, after Christ returns to earth and he sets up his kingdom, will those of us who have already gone to heaven then return with him, or will we still live in heaven, or will we once again live on earth?
Well, the Bible says he's going to make a new heaven and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. So I think the whole system that we have is going to be reordered. But I think we'll return with him. He'll come and the saints will be with him. And I think he's going to reign and rule on earth, but he'll reign in the new Jerusalem. It'll be a place of joy. And, you know, it's kind of like, what's heaven and where's heaven? And we're not really sure. But he's going to make a new heaven and a new earth. The whole universe is going to be reordered. And at that point, I don't know the answer. All right.
But he did such a good job the first time. It's probably going to be wonderful.
Yeah, it'll be without sin, without
exactly.
sin.
Oh, that'd right. be great. This is Katie, who says, where in the Bible does it say that baptism is only by immersion? Is one still baptized if he's been sprinkled?
Read Romans chapter 6. It says we're buried with him in baptism and raised in newness of life. You don't get buried when you get sprinkled. Sprinkling came about because of infant baptism. Mm-hmm. And you can't dunk an infant in a tub of water without it kind of freaking out, I suppose. But in any event, I think the traditional way, John the Baptist baptized in a river.
It's a symbol of all of what you're talking about.
It's buried in baptism, raised in newness of life. Where does the Bible say it's the only way? Well, the Bible doesn't say it's the only way, but it's the way it was.
We're following it, right?
We're following. Mm-hmm. But they had some who would kneel and be baptized, but I wouldn't get hung up on the way of doing things, on these forms and rituals. I think what God's concerned about is your heart, and you want to go into that.